morning and welcome to worship for the Churches of Scotland of the Upper Tay and Tenandry. We're here in Aberfeldy Parish Church this morning, where it's definitely a fairly wet and overcast day outside. The whole theme for this morning's service takes place in the wilderness, in the desert where the Israelites go. And our first hymn, "O God, You Are My God Alone," is a desert psalm. It's a setting of Psalm 63, when the psalmist thirsts for the presence of God. So, "O God, You Are My God Alone."
Let us pray. 100,000 welcomes to you, Jesus Christ. 100,000 welcomes to you. Let our ears be open. Let our souls be stirred. Let our spirits praise, and let our tongues be loosened, and our whole being cry out, 100,000 welcomes to you, Jesus Christ. 100,000 welcomes. For the earth has been green with life, and the seas have teemed, and the air has been filled. The wheat has borne its grain. The ovens have been filled. The table has had food. And all these are signs of your abundant generosity. 100,000 welcomes to you, Jesus Christ. 100,000 welcomes to you. Forgive us when we feared having nothing, when we already had so much. Forgive us when we hoarded, when we could have been generous. Forgive us being overworked, when we could have lived by more restful rhythms. Forgive us. Forgive us all our sins, we pray. And in Jesus Christ, remake us and reunite what has been severed and release what has been burdened and make clean what has been sullied. All this we ask, all this we ask as we praise you and welcome you. 100,000 welcomes to you, Jesus Christ. 100,000 welcomes to you. Amen.
So we're 1,000 feet up above the tea here at Cheneville, where the Angus is...
smartly dressed for church.
Smartly dressed for church, session clerk here in Aberfeldy. And we've also got Chris, who's another one of our members, working away up here, and Darren, he's also part of the church, was here a moment ago. But the reason I'm here is I want to try and find some wilderness. So we're going to go through this this gate here, and this really lovely tunnel of trees, to go and find something that might be a little bit like wilderness. But first of all, Moira is going to read for us from Exodus chapter 16. The Israelites are in the desert and they have a bit of a situation to contend with.
The reading is from Exodus chapter 16, beginning at verse 1. The whole Israelite community set out from Elam and came to the desert of Sin, which is between Elam and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after they had come out of Egypt. In the desert, the whole community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted. But you have brought us out into this desert to starve this entire assembly to death." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I will rain down bread from heaven for you. The people are to go out each day and gather enough for that day. In this way I will test them and see whether they will follow my instructions. On the sixth day, they are to prepare what they bring in, and that is to be twice as much as they gather on the other days." Amen.
Thank you to Moira Thompson, who read for us there. Before we return to the wilderness high up on Cheneville, we're going to spend a moment here to think about the work of Christians Against Poverty, CAP, here in Highland Perthshire. Every single year we have a service here in Aberfeldy where we think about the work of CAP and felt it was really important to continue to do that this year. So first of all, Angela Hanby, who is in charge of the centre here and has run it and birthed it and seen it flourish over many years, she's going to explain a little bit about what Christians Against Poverty, CAP, have been doing over the past year and what they're going to be doing in the times ahead.
Like everyone else, CAP has been affected by COVID this year. I've been on furlough for 3 months and our head office teams had to find ways of developing the model which used to be visiting people in their own homes. And of course that hasn't been possible. So instead, they had to get the technology right and all the digital technical things happening to enable us to maintain the support we give to those struggling with debt. Thankfully, once that was up and running, I came off furlough and a new client booked onto the system and we've been able to help them through the debt management process. Overall this year, we've seen two people go debt-free despite all the difficulties, and that's been great. It was wonderful to make that phone call to let someone know that they had become debt-free and all their debts had been paid off. £45,000 over 5 years. Absolutely amazing, and the chap was delighted. Going forwards into next year, well, the whole debt advice sector see a tsunami of need as the impacts of COVID become a reality for so many. To help us on that journey, CAP Highland Pastor are looking to recruit a new debt coach to support me in the work that we're doing here. CAP Strathearn opened a new debt centre as well in August, so some of the clients that we had been working with moved across to CAP Strathearn. During this current year, and right now, we're supporting 7 clients within the Highland Pastorate area, many who come from Aberfeldy, but one or two who are out with the town. But in addition to that, the volunteer befrienders continue to support clients who have become debt-free, or clients who have chosen not to work with CAP, or who have had difficulty with maintaining the payments into their CAP plan. And it's great to have so many volunteers from the church and other churches supporting these clients through the difficult times. Our fundraising efforts this year have been amazing, with 2 major events despite all that's been going on. We had a wonderful fundraising dinner in February, and 9 people from across the area took part in the Kilt Walked Challenge. And between these 2 events, more than £22,000 was raised, which gives us a significant sum going into next year. Fundraising remains a challenge, but it really does, your support really does make a difference to people's lives. You're changing lives for the better. CAP Strapline is always hope, and you provide that hope with your support. If you'd like to donate, the details are appearing on the screen beneath me and will also appear at the end of this film. Thank you very much for your ongoing support for everyone who is being helped through CAP Highland Pastorate.
One person who many of us know here in the church in Aberfeldy, whose life has been transformed through the work of CAP, is Janice Patton. And Janice is just going to say a little bit now about the difference that CAP and working with them has made to her life.
CAP has changed my life in a big way because I budget now. I managed to keep myself for a fortnight. I was always borrowing money from people and having to pay it back. I have went to CAP events on weekends. I've got a befriender called Ruth and Nick that do a lot for me. It's taken me lots of places. And I've made a lot of friends through the CAP family, which has helped me over time.
We're 1,000 feet up, still just above Aberfeldy. We're at Roar Farm. Looking at these huge selection of buildings all around us here where people lived and worked for many years. But the census, or a copy of the census for this area for 1881, and it says that 7 members of the Dewar family all lived in this area here, in this what is now completely deserted farm area and seemingly high up hostile environment. How did they survive? We're actually 300 acres of arable land up here. And people must have prospered in the 1891 census. There were now 10 people living up in all these buildings here. And then in 1901, nobody. This place went in the space of 10 years from 10 people living here, the Dewar family, to nobody. I don't know what happened. I don't know if they decided they couldn't live here anymore, it was too cold, too remote, or whether they were told to leave. These Gaelic-speaking family, like so many in this area and the areas around, forced to leave. But I wanted to come here today to think about this story of the Israelites in the desert. They've been wandering now for a month and a half. It says the incident we're talking about happened in the second month, the 15th day. They're in a place called the Desert of Sin. And they start to complain or grumble. We actually don't know the real meaning of the word, and I'm about to suggest later on that it's maybe less hostile than people suggested, and the Hebrew word loon is just only used in these passages, so people don't really know how to work out exactly what it meant. But people complain because there's no bread in this wilderness. Somehow they've decided that life can't be sustained anymore. And often when people interpret this passage, they talk about, oh, these ungrateful Israelites, you know, God's done all these things for them. He's taken them out of slavery. He's crossed the Red Sea. And now they're complaining because there's no food. And you're kind of going, fair enough. You know, I get grouchy if I haven't had anything to eat by 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And these people have been going for a month and 15 days without a proper food supply. And there's no sense of complaint in the passage. The only complaint that happens is Moses says, the people complain to Moses and to Aaron, the two leaders, oh, we used to have bread and we used to have meat in Egypt. And later passages, there's definite exaggeration going on, but it's probably true. They maybe didn't always have meat, but they certainly would have had bread. We had bread and meat, and they complained to Moses and Aaron. And the only problem that there seems to be in this bit of the passage anyway is that they have complained to Moses and Aaron when they should have been complaining to God. And the complaint, the grumble, or maybe it is just a legitimate cry of what we really need, drives the story on. And God says, I'm going to rain down bread. This doesn't sound like God is peeved. It sounds like the complaint is the thing that causes the story to move forward. So God says, I'm going to rain down bread in the morning, and it's going to be like frost. And this wilderness, this inhospitable place, this place where you thought you couldn't live, is going to be a place of abundance and hospitality. So the first thing, and I'm going to talk about three things today. The first thing I want to talk about today is simply the fact that it is the complaint, or sometimes the grumbling, to God, which drives the story on. It is the very fact of being prepared and brave enough to articulate to God that which we feel, whether it's justified or not, is what then provokes God to say there's going to be bread in the morning, and later on we discover quail are going to land in the afternoon. It's the complaint in the wilderness, which I argue is legitimate complaint, is what drives the story on. And this part of the story says to us, what is your deepest hunger? Give it to God. What is your deepest yearning? Give it to God. What is your deepest lack or pain? God brings us to the wilderness almost, I think, sometimes, in order that we might discover what that thing actually is. And then the complaint, the yearning, is what pushes the story to the place where God moves to abundance. So here in the wilderness, the first question is, what do you want to complain about? There are grounds for complaining. So pass your complaint to God. The story seems to suggest that God is listening.
Well, we've just come down now into Aberfeldy. It's 6:30 in the morning, and in a moment we're going to find out why we're here and at this time. But now Moira's going to read the next part of the story. So all the complainings happened, and now this is what happens next in the story.
The second reading continues the story at verse 11 in Exodus chapter 16. The Lord said to Moses, I have heard the grumbling of the Israelites. Tell them, at twilight you will eat meat, and in the morning you will be filled with bread. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God. That evening quail came and covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the dew was gone, thin flakes like frost on the ground appeared on the desert floor. When the Israelites saw it, they said to each other, what is it? for they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, "It is the bread the Lord has given you to eat. This is what the Lord has commanded. Each one is to gather as much as he needs. Take an omer for each person you have in your tent." The Israelites did as they were told. Some gathered much, some little. And when they measured it by the omer, he who gathered much did not have too much. He who gathered little did not have too little. Each one gathered as much as he needed. Amen, and may God grant his blessing to this reading from his holy word.
So, a few things to notice in that story. Firstly, bread every single day, or manna. The second thing is that the manna has this ability, no matter how much you pick up, to find itself to every mouth that needs fed, and just enough to be satisfied, not more. And also on the sixth day, Friday, the day before the Sabbath, there is double the amount needed in order to sustain the people through the next day. And then almost as an afterthought in the story, it's not made a big deal of, but every evening, quail arrives, food. So you've got bread covering a wilderness every day. You've got bread that has this ability to find itself to every hungry mouth. You've got bread that seems to know that before the day of rest, there needs to be double. And the reason that we've come to think about this at this time in the morning is we're going to go to this place here just around the corner. I'm going to don my mask. And it's 6:30 in the morning, and apparently we're allowed to be here. We've arranged it, so let's see how we get on. Many of you have worked out now, we're at the Aberfeldy Bakery. Here we go. I'm told to knock the door. Hello? Nobody here. Morning. Oh, morning. We'd arranged to, I spoke to the owners yesterday about coming to film here this morning at 6:30, and she said it was okay to come through to the shop. Yeah. Yeah, so what's your name?
David.
So David, you're one of the bakers here, is that right?
Yeah, I am.
Yeah. Yeah, and what's your mum called?
Elinda,
and what's your surname?
Kirsten.
Oh, good. Yeah,
she's
yeah.
She's a Morris, but I'm a Kirsten.
You're a Kirsten. Yeah. And have you been here since midnight, baking bread?
Yeah, since midnight, with my sister, yeah.
And what, your sister does
yeah,
it?
Yeah, my sister as well, yeah, she's stuck here.
So what breads have you cooked this morning?
A bit of everything, really. You have to come through and have a look.
Yeah, is that all right?
Yeah.
Brilliant, sure. Thanks.
Oh, the shop's nice and full, so...
Yeah, that's why we came. I thought if we came in the afternoon, then all the bread would be gone.
I
feel quite excited. It's behind the scenes. Is this the kitchen through here?
Yeah.
Okay, here we are. Here, I'm just gonna take a wee sneak. Here's where it all happens. Look at this. Fantastic. Oh, I'm coming through here, David. Now, here's the back shop. Here is Sophia. Hello, Sophia. Good morning. Not bad. Sophia is one of the hardest working people in the whole of Aberfeldy. You work here, Sophia, don't you? And you work in the co-op as well.
Yeah.
Thanks, David. And here is all the bread up here, all ready to go out for the day. And then this fabulous selection. Have you, David, have you cooked all the tray bakes and sweets overnight as well? Or do they just get done? Oh, so all of this was created last night and ready for today. And you've been up since midnight doing that?
Yeah, I've been up about 11:00 at night and then come in for midnight. Yeah.
Wow. And then do you just sleep during the day?
Yeah, we get to bed about 3-4 o'clock in the afternoon.
Yeah. Oh, it's brilliant. So impressive.
Thank you very much.
Oh, well. The reason we've come here this morning is to get this very visible portrait of abundance. All this bread ready for the people of Aberfeldy and beyond today. And I wouldn't describe this bit here as essentials, but certainly the joy of life is here. And one of the things that happens in the desert story is that for 40 years, the people of Israel
have no choice but to understand that every single item of food that they will eat, the bread that they will eat in the morning and the quail that they will eat at night, every single item has come as a result of a miracle of the abundant goodness of God. That's one of the lessons they learn in the wilderness. There's no such thing as a meal which isn't a miracle. Every single one has come from God. And what if that hasn't changed? What if that is exactly the same now? What if every single loaf of bread here and every single item of sweetness and joy and of colour, what if all of that was ultimately the miraculous goodness of God? And part of us resists that. We say, God can't do that. God's too busy doing other stuff. But what if God is big enough to do all of this? And the issue is, in fact, that we simply resist believing in the miracle. The writer Stanley Hauerwas, kind of widely respected Christian thinker, says that sometimes actually our issue with God is not that we can't handle that God is too far away. It's almost that we cannot handle that God is too near. That all of life is a sign of the miraculous presence of God. And we are given a choice as to how we respond, whether we move into the gift, accepting it and enjoying it, or somehow we resist the idea that this can truly be God. Ultimately, that's the heart of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Remember, God is near, the kingdom is near. And we can make this mistake in the church as well, where although we use the language of grace, of presence, the way we often speak is you've got to work so hard and you've got to be so good in order just to have the tiniest morsel of God. And that there are moments notice the God we often talk about will back away from us at the slightest error or the simplest theological mistake, and God's going, I'm out of here. What if it's exactly the opposite? What if it is that God is so unbelievably present and that we are being summoned into seeing the bigness of that gift? Hauerwas comments that we have made God too scarce. And in fact, every single moment of love, every single moment of joy, every single moment of peace is a summons to pause in gratitude and sense that God is behind it all, providing and giving to God's people. Where does that speak to you? Where are the gifts around you? Every single one of them from God. We're now going to head back up to Roar Farm, to think about the final part of the story.
Just had an amazing thing. We've just come out here, and now you can see these jackdaws above us here. I've never seen so many of them like this. And immediately, I thought of the quail that happens in the other part of the story that descends. And then I thought, and my instant instinct was, wow, there's so much birds here. What a brilliant reminder from God this morning of all the quail. Look at them. I've never seen them as many like this. And then another part of me goes, oh, no, Neil, you're just reading too many coincidences into life. It's just they happen here every morning. You just happen to be here. And I think that's a dynamic that happens so often. There are so many moments for me where I sense the presence of God. I see it in every rainbow. I see it so often in a phone call that just happens at the right time. I see it when I think I've been thinking about it, suddenly comes up in a book at the exact right chapter. There are so many moments that I sense God.
And then another voice kicks in that says, oh no, Neil, that's just a coincidence. Neil, you're just overreading. Neil, you're just looking for too many sermon illustrations. But what if? What if God is so abundant that it's actually all from God? What if it just so happened that God was thinking, I'll give them a little picture of the quail as well, because everyone talks about the bread. Let's talk about the quail. And I'm going to send all these jackdaws, I think these are jackdaws, just over their head, just at the right moment. What if God is big enough to accommodate every single thing that we write off as coincidence? What if? Now, definitely this time, we're going back up to Roar Farm.
So in order to think about the last part of this story, which is about our fear of scarcity, we'll come back here to this rock. I'm guessing people must have had a piece on this rock when they lived up here on the farm. I've got two products of the bakery here. I've got some bread, I've actually turned the top two slices into what was my staple diet when I was a young person, which is a marmalade sandwich here and bakery, so very nice. But in some ways, manna, which means what is it, we don't know what it was. Often we think about it as bread, but we don't know. It's a question. So I tried to think what substance could most accurately represent manna. And from the bakery again in Aberfeldy, I reckon that the substance that most represents manna is probably white chocolate Rocky Road cake. So manna from heaven, certainly this stuff is. So just as there were two aspects to the abundance, that the bread found its way to all the mouths which need fed, and secondly, that on the day before the Sabbath, the sixth day, there was double the amount to sustain. Those two aspects of abundance have with them two fears that people operate on in the story. The first is that some people did hoard. They didn't just eat what they needed for that day, they tried to keep more. And what happened then was that the food that they hoarded turned into worms that went rotten. And then the second part was a violation of this idea that on the sixth day you got double, on the Sabbath you rested. And what happened was on the first Sabbath, some people actually went out looking for bread. Why did they go out? I think because they were scared. They were scared that maybe there wasn't quite the abundance that they needed, but perhaps just for some irrational sense that they just had to keep gathering, had to keep working. Too scared to rest. Too scared to trust in abundance. And this desert becomes a place where Sabbath economics becomes important. And people are tested to say, do you really believe in these Sabbath economics, that God will give enough? Or do you become terrorized by a myth of scarcity that you have to hoard and you have to overwork? It's the only time in the story that Moses and becomes angry, and there is anger from God because people have violated these Sabbath economics. The temptation to hoard and the temptation to overwork. And we know these too well. And what this story says, those two things are actually symptoms of our fear of scarcity and our inability or our unwillingness to trust in abundance. And I want to think about where does that apply? Well, firstly, it's a challenge to the way that we live with food. That we are taught in this passage not to hoard, and to see that there is a more equal distribution of food. so many studies have shown that where societies are more equal, where food is distributed in a more even way, then those societies are happier. Richard Wilkinson, a professor, has done a lot of work in this in his book Spirit Level. And the book is subtitled, Why More Equal Societies Almost Always Do Better. So it's a challenge for how we live simply and how we distribute food. It's also a challenge to the way that we live within ourselves. Brené Brown, the author, talks about this. She says that if we believe in scarcity, then very often we believe that we are not enough and we do not have enough to cope with the people around us, so we build armour around ourselves and we become defensive, or we don't let people in to know us. And similarly, she says if we believe in abundance, then she uses the phrase having a soft front but a strong spine. She says if we believe in abundance, then we believe that we are enough in our relationships. We are able to give. We are able to be generous. We are able to offer time. We do not overwork and we do not hoard. So the final thing I want to say on this story today is, how are you challenged by Sabbath economics? Where do you hoard because you're scared? Where do you get defensive because you're scared? Where do you overwork because you're scared? Turn your attention to those things and instead believe in Sabbath economics, that God provides manna from heaven for you. Amen.
That was Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah, a great hymn of wandering in the desert and of God bringing down bread from heaven. One of those who's become more involved in the work of CAP more recently is Andrew Todd, and he is going to lead us in our prayers for others.
Dear God, where your people cry out because the crops have failed, may there still be bread. May there still be a future. Where they cry out because the earth has become too hot or water has become too scarce, may there still be bread. May there still be a future. We pray for the work of CAP here in Highland Perthshire. We pray for the conversations that open up the possibility of a future, We pray for the financial arrangements which undo the weight of debt. Lord, we praise you for those who have become debt-free, even in these last weeks. And we pray for Angela and Sam and the team of folks here. Bless their work. We pray for funding for CAP, that this will come when it is needed. We take a moment to pause to name those before you for whom life is not easy, through money problems or health problems or family problems or problems known only to them and you. In the silence, we name them before you. And now hear us as we pray through the words of Jesus. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Closing hymn is that wonderful hymn of God's abundance, love divine, all loves excelling. May God bless you with bread, bread that fills your body and bread that is nourishment for your soul. May God bless you with good company, friends around you, whether next to you or those who talk to you from afar. May God bless you with abundance in all things. Go and be blessed in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.